Hello, everyone. My name is Nan Li. I got my PhD from George Mason University this year. Currently, I'm a test engineer at Medidata Solutions, where I'm leading the research in software testing and developing test frameworks. Today, I'm going to talk about model-based testing and how to do test automation in model-based testing. In model-based testing, testers derive tests from behavioral models. Generally, there are two reasons for us to use model-based testing. First, models are widely used in industry to design complicated software systems. It's, for instance, UML state machine diagrams are used to describe behaviors of software systems, such as control software used at high-speed trains, cars, and planes. So it's natural for us to adapt design models as test models. Second, we use the models to decide what to test. At the International Conference on Software Testing, Verification, and Validation in 2014, the director from Lockheed Martin, Tom Wiesink, gave a keynote speech. In his speech, he showed how software systems evolve for fighters developed by Lockheed Martin. And we were able to see software systems currently are very complicated, with millions of lines of code, with lots of complicated software components. So we cannot test everything. We have to decide what to test. So we use models to get an abstract test, get abstraction of the system at some level. In his conclusion, he thinks model-based testing is the future. Next, I'm going to show basic steps of model-based testing. In this model-based testing research, I generated criteria-based tests. That means I use coverage criteria to generate test requirements. Coverage criteria are rules about how to generate test requirements. Test requirements are artifacts that have to be covered in tests. I use the UML state machine diagrams of the models. So these diagrams are treated as general graphs. Therefore, apply the graph coverage criteria to the models to generate the test requirements, which are subpaths on a graph. Test requirements have to be covered in tests, especially in abstract tests first. Abstract tests are defined in terms of the model, which are test paths that starts from an initial node and ends with a final node. Then abstract tests cannot be executed directly because they're not concrete tests. They have to be converted into concrete tests, such as JUnit tests. To transform from abstract tests to concrete tests, testers have to provide additional information, such as mappings and test values. When we have concrete tests, they can be executed and reported. In today's talk, I'm going to focus on how to automate the mapping process from abstract tests to concrete tests. I'm going to show an example about how we do model-based testing. This is a finance thing for a simplified vending machine system. State one is the first state when vending machine system starts. And state four is a final state. There are three basic actions. Service persons can add chocolates into the vending machine. Customers can insert coins and then buy chocolates. There are some constraints defining this vending machine system. For instance, in state one, credit has to be equal to zero, and the number of chocolates in stock has to be equal to zero. We can apply various coverage criteria to this model. For instance, if we use node coverage, all states have to be covered in tests. If we use edge coverage, all transitions have to be covered in tests. If we use a more complicated coverage criterion, the test requirements may be a set of subpaths with various lengths. So a problem is that how should we generate test paths to cover all the test requirements with minimum costs? Costs can be defined in terms of the total number of test paths, the total number of nodes in the tests, etc. This problem is proved to be a set of NP-complete problems. If you have more interest, you can read my ICST 2012 paper and my dissertation. Now, abstract tests have actions. For each action, we have to find a corresponding test code for them. In the meanwhile, constraints included in the tests have to be covered as well. So how to transform abstract tests to concrete tests is called the mapping problem. In this test path, this test path has ad hoc action appear twice, coin action appear twice, and get hoc appear once. If we have a complete set of test paths, we'll find out these three basic actions will appear multiple times. If we generate concrete tests for these abstract tests, testers may write lots of redundant test code. The reason is the test code for the same action may be similar or similar. So we want to automate this mapping process. The problem of previous research is that they use a lot of additional models, such as object diagrams, class diagrams, and use case diagrams. And these models have to be highly consistent. That means parameter used in one model has to be identified in another model. In practice, this is really hard for testers to maintain the highly consistent relationships among them. So my solution is that to let testers to use a test automation language to create mappings from the model to executable test code by using only one behavioral model, such as a state machine diagram. For state machine diagrams, there are two identifiable elements that need mappings, transitions and constraints. Testers can create element mappings for transitions and constraints. If the test code of element mappings require objects, testers can create object mappings to initialize objects. Next, I'm going to show you the definitions of element mapping and object mapping. Each element mapping has to have a unique mapping name following the keyword mapping. All keywords are in red. Each element mapping can be defined for a constraint or a transition. If the test code of element mappings require objects, and we can use additional object mappings to initialize these objects. Square brackets means this part is optional because this part is using only for element mappings for constraints. Constraints can be used as preconditions, postconditions, and state invariants. Test code is included in the curly brackets. Similarly, object mapping has to have a unique mapping name. And it also has to specify the kind of class and object name. If the test code for this object initialization also requires additional parameters, we can use additional object mappings to initialize parameters. Similarly, test code is included in the curly brackets. Next, I'm going to show a few examples about how we write element mappings and object mappings. This is an example of element mapping for transition coin. In the test code, first we initialize the vending machine system, and then we insert a dollar into the vending machine system. If the vending machine object initialization is also used by other element mappings, we can extract this part and put it into a separated object mapping. And we give a mapping name VM init. Then the previous element mapping becomes this, and which requires the object mapping VM init. This is another element mapping for a constraint, which requires the credit has to be greater than zero. This constraint is used as state invariants in state 2 and state 4. Now that we have mappings for constraints and transitions, and then concrete test automation, test generation can be automated. for the test generation, we have to select the proper mappings for transitions so that constraints can be satisfied. When constraints in state 3 are satisfied, we need to select a mapping for coin so that constraints in state 4 are also satisfied. If the selected mapping cannot satisfy the constraints in state 4, we have to select another mapping. If all mappings cannot satisfy the constraints, testers will be notified and they need to provide additional mappings. If testers are not able to provide any mapping to satisfy the constraints, that means either the model or program has something wrong, or there's a mismatch between the model and the program. In summary, testers can use the test automation language to automate the mapping process from abstract tests to concrete tests by using only one behavioral model. From the study of model-based testing research, I learned one lesson. I was able to do some test automation techniques for the mapping process and the test generation. And the basis is that requirements are included in a format that can be understood by computers. In this case, requirements are described in state machine diagrams. So we want to apply this idea to practice at Medidata. At Medidata Solutions, we processing and transforming terabytes or even petabytes clinical trial data for reporting purposes. If requirements are written in plain English, it's really hard for us to do any test automation. So we plan to use a different test automation language or specification language to transform original requirements into some sort of format. Then our test framework can read this newly formatted requirements and evaluate the transformed data against the original data, and then the whole validation process will be automated. Thank you for your listening.
Thank you very much, Dan. Do we have any questions on the moderator link? No. Any live questions? All right.
So model-based testing is interesting for small applications with a small state space, but as soon as you have a more complex, application, modeling the application becomes much more difficult. And are you doing anything different here to make that easier?
Yeah, yes, you're absolutely right. When software systems are very complicated, we have to decide at which abstraction level we generate the models. If we use too many, for instance, if we want to create state machine diagrams and we use too many parameters, it's really the states is going to be exploring. We have too many states, and it's harder for us to do tests.
So are you doing anything differently? Are you doing anything to make it simpler to model a more complex application? Because otherwise you end up recreating the entire application in the model test space.
Yes, so for my research, my focus was on a given model and how should we derive tests from the model. So, but next, you know, at Medidata, we plan to do some model-based testing for real. That's in practice, we will figure out how we generate models. And that's gonna be our future research part.
Yeah. Thank you, Nan.
Okay.
Great talk.
Thank you.
Thank you.